whatever you want, whatever you need, anything you want done, baby, I'll do it naturally, 'cause I'm every woman, it's all in.
Hi, my name is Aisha Fains. I'm the founder of Women Love Power. And if you have been on my website, womenlovepower.com, there's a very big chance that you have seen the Feminine Archetypes Assessment. It is a quiz. And what this quiz does is it really gives you a blueprint for your personality, helping you understand which archetypes are dominant in your psyche, having the greatest influence on your life and your personality, what you value, your behaviors, your desire, what you are drawn to and who you attract, what you attract. And also those archetypes that are somewhat underrepresented as well, which have equally an impact on who you are at your core. And what the assessment also does is it leads you to your unique captivation archetype, your seduction archetype, and it shows you how you uniquely seduce, how you uniquely beguile and enchant. It's a combination of the lover archetype with your dominant archetype. So for example, my seduction archetype is a sophisticate because I am dominant lover energy and nearly tied with sage energy. And so today I really want to make all of that make sense. I want to make it make sense. I think that archetypes are something best experienced, is best seen. I want you to see the archetypes in action because that's going to give you a level of understanding that no article can. And I also want to help you make sense of how all of the archetypes sort of work together and why all women really have to have the capacity to connect to all of the archetypes. So even though two or three, you know, really no more than three will be dominant, really influencing your psyche, you really do need to be able to connect to all seven of these archetypes in order to really experience true fulfillment in your life, in your pursuit of wealth, in your pursuit of abundance, and certainly in managing your relationships and attracting really healthy and radiant love. According to psychiatrist Carl Jung, archetypes are these instinctive and universal patterns and images that are burrowed deep into the human collective unconscious, where they form the foundation of all of our unlearned instinctive patterns of behavior. And according to Jungian psychology, the ego represents our conscious mind, it represents our social mask, and the behaviors that we are very much aware of, while that unconscious mind serves as a form of psychological inheritance. And it's the unconscious mind that contains all of our instinctive and native knowledge and experiences. And this is where these archetypal characters exist. So whether or not humans were gathered around a fire thousands of years ago telling each other stories, or they were gathered around a television in the living room listening to stories and watching stories play out, humans understand the world and they understand each other through story. It is one of the oldest forms of communication. It is really a part of us that is a part of the human experience, storytelling. And characters, from the king to the maiden to the queen to the lover, these characters, these archetypal characters, resonate in and out of time. And these characters that we innately understand are archetypes. These are archetypal characters, and they not only are part of our tradition of storytelling, but they are part of us. It's stories are how we looked at each other and we made sense of the human experience, and we made sense of the greater experience happening beyond us. There are seven feminine archetypes that prevail in our contemporary society. They are the mother, the maiden, the queen, the huntress, the sage, the mystic, and the lover. Now, each of these feminine archetypes is a unique aspect or expression of feminine energy, which is one of the reasons why the term feminine energy is so often misused, because a lot of times it's used interchangeably with the lover archetype, which is really represents, and we're going to get into this in just a moment, but represents sort of your erotic, creative life force. But it is not the only representation of feminine energy. It's not the only expression of feminine energy. So all of these archetypes represent different expressions of feminine energy. Spending time with all seven archetypes, particularly those that are underrepresented in your personality, can help you overcome the personal challenges and the negative behaviors that thwart your growth. And each and every one of us really needs to establish some connection with all seven archetypes in order to thrive. The lover is our gateway to sacred sensuality, creativity, passion, and our innate ability to captivate. The huntress, it's our path to independence in our warrior spirit. The maiden brings about intuition, creativity, and the ability to withstand and endure periods of darkness in order to transform and step into our light. The sage is a gateway to accomplishment, wisdom, and the ability to compartmentalize our emotions. The queen is the key to confidence, leadership, social alliances, the ability to attract the finer things in life, and yes, the ability to attract a husband. The mother enables us to nurture, create, protect, and ultimately to establish deep, real, heart-centered relationships, to leave that space of the head and get to the heart. And the mystic is our pathway to freedom, inner peace, and that seductive allure of mystery that must be present in any relationship. Understanding my archetypes really helped me not only create a career for myself that would be very fulfilling and that I could commit to, but it also helped me understand who I was attracting and why I was attracting them, and what my strengths were in my relationships and what my weaknesses, what I had to work on in my relationships. It just really, archetypes helped me completely revamp my entire life. Like, they helped me in my entire life together. It's the reason why I made archetypes the benchmark of womenlovepower.com. Like, for those of you who've been with me since the very beginning, my website actually went up like in beta mode in like 2015, archetypes were the first thing that were on there. Before there was like anything else for a year, it was just information about archetypes. So it's powerful stuff. During this video, we're going to be exploring all seven archetypes a bit, but for those of you who are ready to really not just explore them in a cursory way, but to dive deep into these archetypes, to really understand them, their modern day incarnations and their ancient expressions as well, the mythology behind them, and to understand how you can literally connect to each archetype and really make the most of who you are, I would encourage you to check below for information on the Feminine Odyssey. And even if you don't take the entire Feminine Odyssey, which is seven master classes, each diving deep into the seven feminine archetypes, I would certainly encourage you to take the first of the feminine archetype, the first master class, which goes into the lover and really explores how we engage and cultivate and embrace and understand this energy. So it's probably going to be the most significant and efficient course that's on the site. You know, it's a course that you're going to be able to get through pretty easily, and it's gonna probably have an instant impact on your life. So check that out. And with that, let's talk about the seven archetypes, and we're gonna start with the lover.
The principles of lust are easy to understand. Do what you feel, feel until the end. The principles of lust are burned in your mind.
made you cross?
Give me my crutch.
Why don't you put on your nice silk pajamas, honey, and come on down to the party? There's a lovely cool breeze.
Give me my crutch, Maggie.
Lean on me, baby.
So the lover might be referred to as Shakti, Kundalini, as passion, as Eros, in mythology, personified in deities from Aphrodite to Oshun. The lover is that energy. It really is an expression of the erotic, creative energy and the creative potential in women. It's the attracting force that is behind the most basic instinct that human beings have in order to survive. And what is that? It's the instinct to procreate. And the lover, if I could explain it most simply, it is the attracting force that compels people to connect and create. But the thing about it is this energy, when you really understand it, is not just the energy behind sexual attraction, but it's also the energy that inspires all creativity. And it is really, really is loving energy. It's literally the energy of love. And when you learn how to channel it, not only do you channel it to become sort of magnetic, because at the end of the day, it is an attracting force. And so people who are connected and aligned with their lover energy, women who are connected with this energy are inspiring. They have that it factor. They have that je ne sais quoi. They're magnetic. But it also can be channeled into actually creating things out of love, like harmony, like beauty, like art. No surprise that a lot of women who are dominant lovers, you will find in artistic and creative careers. Because they are natural creators. This is the energy that compels us to captivate, to create, and connect. If you had to reduce it to three words, it would be that: captivate, create, connect. When you're aligned with this energy, those things come really readily to you. It's also the energy that helps us feel good. It's the energy that helps us get really comfortable in our bodies, in our skin, and helps us make that trip from the head to the heart. And it's the revitalizing energy. It's the difference between who you are when you've been cooped up in your cubicle for weeks upon weeks upon weeks versus who you are on vacation when you're out in the sun by the sand and the shore and you're relaxed and you feel good in your skin and you're laughing. It's that energy. It's that it factor. It's that, that woman has something. It is that energy. And that is why it's the basis for the seduction archetypes, because when women are really aligned with this powerful energy, she becomes seductive. She becomes magnetic. That's ultimately the purpose of the energy to begin with. In pop culture, you see it all around. This energy is everything from Sandra on 227.
Oh, look, I'm not decent.
And Delta Burke and Designing Woman, Elizabeth Taylor and Cat on a Hot Tin Roof, Samantha Jones and Sex in the City.
Look, if you're a successful saleswoman in this city, you have two choices. You can bang your head against the wall and try and find a relationship, or you can say screw it and just go out and have sex like a man.
Pop stars like Jennifer Lopez, Rita Hayworth in Gilda, Regine in A Living Single.
All my life I've had one simple dream: to make the world look as good as me.
This is the archetype that's used to sell us products, everything from perfume to chocolate to makeup, anything that promises romance, beauty, harmony, and feminine allure. I would also say that it's the most misunderstood energy of all the feminine energy. I think over time, because this energy is so powerful, because it defies logic, because it has a hypnotic effect, I think that along with the suppression and oppression of womankind, we've also suppressed this energy. We suppress pleasure. We suppress sexuality. We wrap the feminine body in shame. And we've deliberately misunderstood the capacity of this energy, in part because we've separated sex from energy. We made sex his very anatomical and shameful affair. And we've taken the energy of what's actually happening on an energetic level out of it. So we've lost some of the reverence for this energy, if you will. So it's really misunderstood. And so a lot of times when you see the lover archetype in pop culture, it's sort of a parody or a caricature.
We ran for some real bad weather. Ice, rain, and snow.
Are you ready for me, Daddy?
Of the real potential of this archetype, and the real potential of this archetype is to be able to literally use loving energy to create your reality. It really puts the power in your hands. It is the most empowering energy that a woman has access to. And so, embracing the lover is more so than being sexy, because that's such a slither of what this energy is about. When we look at the most seductive women of all time, they are all highly attuned to this energy, from Beyonce to Halle Berry, to the cool sirens like Sade, Audrey Hepburn, Diane Carroll, Jacqueline Kennedy. The thing is, this energy expresses itself very differently, depending on the presence of other dominant archetypes. So it can express itself as a very cool heat if it's paired with, say, sage energy or huntress energy, or like a Sade with and who's a goddess with mystic energy. But it could also express a very enchanting, warm, earthy magnetism if it's paired with, say, mother energy like Sophia Loren or Nia Long, or queen energy like Beyonce. So think of it like a spotlight. The lover energy literally puts a spotlight on you. It's the light. It works like a lighthouse, right? And think of the other archetypes almost like the gels you put over the spotlight. So depending on the presence of other archetypes, that light looks different, but the light is shining as long as that lover energy is there.
I want the world to know. Got to let it show.
Just love the picture. I did. But I just felt so sorry for the creature at the end.
Sorry for the creature? Why'd you want him to marry the girl?
He was kind of scary looking, but he wasn't really all bad. I think he just craved a little affection, you know, a sense of being loved and needed and wanted.
That's a very interesting point of view.
Oh, do you feel the breeze from the subway? Isn't it delicious?
So then there's the maiden. The maiden is unmistakable. She is effervescent. She's youthful. It doesn't matter how old she is. She's not necessarily stuck in her youth and youthful to the point where it's a caricature, but there's something fresh about her. There's something natural about her. There's something unaffected about her. Think Josephine Baker. Think Diana Ross. Think Marilyn Monroe, Audrey Hepburn, especially in Breakfast at Tiffany's playing Holly Golightly. Holly Golightly was also a maiden figure, an ingenue figure, a mixture of the lover and the maiden energy.
And you look a little like my brother Fred. Do you mind if I call you Fred?
Not at all.
Princess Diana. Whitley Gilbert in A Different World. Uma Thurman in Pulp Fiction. I think this is one of the energies that are a little bit more complicated to understand, a little bit more complicated to work with, because the truth is the maiden has two sides. There's sort of a very clear darkness and light side to the maiden. And if you go on the website, you'll understand a little bit more. I talk about sort of the story of Persephone, the abduction of Persephone. And again, we're going to talk about that in the masterclass. But essentially, the maiden has a core energy, and that's when the maiden is truly in her maiden state. She's truly the archetypal daughter. And so she is codependent. A daughter is a daughter because she is daughter to a mother and father. So her identity is relational. And so when a lot of women who identify with this energy are in sort of what we call the core phase, they struggle to make decisions for themselves. They struggle to take control over their lives. They may be a little naive. They may be drawn to dark figures. And there's actually an archetypal reason why. Who we're attracted to is very much based on these archetypes. They may be a little rebellious. Think of Rihanna. A lot of people are shocked when I say Rihanna is actually a strong maiden, because she's not, you know, like a lollipop kind of pink, you know, Britney Spears figure. She's kind of got a rambunctiousness to her, but that's actually an expression of the maiden energy as well. And then there's the mature maiden, and the mature maiden becomes somewhat of a queen in her own right. And she is a woman who's totally integrated, and she now has a deeper understanding of the world. She's still effervescent, but not as naive. She is intuitive. She's introverted. She's creative. And she has gone through some sort of transformation, some sort of darkness, and come out of it sort of in her queen phase. And so there are maiden figures who go through that queen phase and come out more so identifying actually with the mother energy. And then there are those who really embody the fullness of the maiden. I think Princess Diana is a great example. After her divorce with Charles, you can see a total transformation. I love this clip of Diana Ross talking about how motherhood prompted her transformation.
I had children, I had to take responsibility for myself, and I just had to grow up and just be real. And I didn't start until I, but also I'm talking about being a woman, all right, about making decisions for myself, and that I didn't need a man around to do that exactly, that I could say yes and I could say no if I didn't want to do something, that being in charge
of your
own self.
You had control of your own destiny and
it
yourself.
It was beginning around that.
And you
it took
found,
a long time.
but making this to the personal aspect of it, you also at that time began to feel more sensual and sexual and confident.
Yeah, because
confident
once I left the Supremes, for some reason, if you notice the pictures up to the time I left the Supremes, I was so skinny before. I started to gain weight, you know. I started to be healthier in my body.
Yeah.
I know.
Yeah. I do know.
Yeah.
Yeah. But and
it's true.
And
I realized I was a sexual being somewhere in there. But it didn't start early.
And rather than a product, you were a person
with thoughts and feelings and
yeah. Mm-hmm. And did your relationship with men change after that?
Yeah.
No,
it's always
I mean.
Been like that.
No, you know what I mean. I mean, the better you think of yourself, the better the relationship is going to be, clearly. I mean, the more self-esteem you have, this is human relationship 101. Yeah.
Better choices of men that are good and, you know, that you can admire. And
you begin to like a different kind of man?
Yeah. Someone that's nice to me, good to me.
That maiden women kind of must go through. But we all actually take on this archetype whenever we go through a challenging period in our lives. And there is no life without a period of darkness, a cycle of darkness, because life is cyclical. You can watch the surrender video I did to understand that. We all take on this archetype energy when we're enduring that, and understanding this energy and understanding the actual phases of feminine transformation and of cycles of change can help you really get through whatever is happening in your life, whatever dark phase is happening in your life. So that's one of the big advantages of being able to connect to and understand the maiden energy for anyone. This is the energy overall of transformation and renewal, but it also helps all of us connect to our ability to live a little, to maintain that inner child, to see the world through new and young eyes. To not take things too seriously, you know, the seductive effect of kind of just being natural and unaffected, to empathize, to be able to commiserate with people. So there's so many advantages of connecting to the maiden energy.
I want to be free, and I just got to be me. my client the house, the Winnebago, alimony, and 70% of all the assets he tried to conceal. I left that man with nothing but a lint ball and half a Tic Tac.
I think Maxine Shaw from Living Single might be my favorite huntress, my favorite fictional huntress figure. Maxine the Maverick. The huntress, she aims at a target and she reaches it. She doesn't miss. The huntress is the wild woman. The huntress is the woman who runs with wolves. She represents the independent female spirit. So when I was talking about the maiden and how the archetypal daughter exists in relation to something, you are a daughter of a mother and a father. The huntress is one unto herself, right? She doesn't need anyone to define her. She doesn't need to be defined in relation to someone. She's a total and complete woman, whether she's with someone or she's not. So she represents that independence, that female independence. It's the expression of femininity that is untarnished and untainted by patriarchal norms. Like the goddess Artemis, the Greek goddess Artemis, who lived out in the woods, didn't even mess around with the other deities of Mount Olympus. She was out in the woods running with the nymphs and stirring up trouble over there. But that really very much represents that this woman is sort of removed from sort of the idea of a woman growing up as a daughter and then becoming someone's lover and then somebody's wife and then somebody's mother. It's the idea of a woman having her own identity for herself. It's the independent female spirit. Angelina Jolie, in real life and in just about every role she's ever played, is this. Erykah Badu, the eccentric songstress who has been known to be a devastating siren, and one of the reasons is because if you take the five laws of feminine power, you'll know what I mean. But all seduction requires a bit of distance and a bit of emotional distance and a bit of physical distance. And women who identify with the huntress do this naturally. They do it instinctively. They don't even have to think about it. There's something about them that is will always remain their own, right? And that is infinitely enticing and seductive when they are able to really channel that and pair it with their lover energy. Marlene Dietrich, that cool, oozing huntress energy coming out of Marlene Dietrich, who was the perfect coquette, dominant huntress, secondary lover. Serena Williams, you can see that fiery spirit on the court. And you also can see it's not one-dimensional to see her as a wife and to see her as a mother and to see her off the court inspiring women. She's a quintessential huntress. She's inspiring. She's a natural leader. She goes for what she wants. She sets a goal and she gets it. Even when it just defies everything we know, she's still winning championships at an age where most athletes have phased out. Lisa Bonet, Solange, you know, emerged out of her big sister's footsteps because she's got such an original and independent take on music. Julia Roberts, take character in My Best Friend's Wedding, perfect huntress.
You're in a fancy French restaurant. You order creme brulee for dessert. It's beautiful. It's sweet. It's irritatingly perfect. Suddenly, Michael realizes he doesn't want creme brulee. He wants something else. What does he want? Jello.
Women can cultivate the huntress in order to develop their own identity. And their sense of identity apart from their husband, apart from their parents, apart from what society tells them to be. This is the energy that's going to help you define you for yourself. This is the energy that's also going to help you not be codependent. So for people who have a tendency to be doormats in relationships or who have a tendency to kind of cling and have a hard time letting go in relationships, for people who have a hard time kind of remaining, maintaining a little bit of a cool, you know, in affairs of the heart, the huntress is going to help with that. The huntress helps you assert yourself. It helps you speak up. This energy is about asserting who you are. It's about speaking up, speaking your truth, speaking your mind. It's about commanding your worth. This is also the energy of feminine rage. We often associate femininity with all things delicate, sugar, and spice, and that's not true. There are aspects of femininity that are not pretty. And feminine feminine rage has been directed towards very positive things throughout the history of, you know, mankind. When women get fed up, they end wars, they protest, you know, they organize, and they use collective action to inspire change. So feminine rage is actually can be a great thing. And so when directed towards a positive purpose. And so this is that archetype of really getting fired up about something, getting fired up around a purpose, and really like it's using that to inspire change. And this is the energy that's really going to help you focus, go after goals, attack goals with confidence and bravado, and compete. This is that energy, cultivating the huntress energy.
But I'm clever.
Thinking you could take what's mine, and should you make that mistake again, remember this. You can't take Olivia Pope. Olivia Pope takes you.
The sage archetype represents focus, pragmatism, wisdom, strategy, intellect, accomplishment. Also represents creativity. So a lot of people are surprised to find that Martha Stewart is a sage, but sage energy governs not just a woman's ability to strategize her way to the top of her professional field, like Martha Stewart has done, but it also governs our creativity and the domestic arts. So a lot of women who are sage women are also creative women. They take pleasure in running their homes. My mother is a sage woman who loves everything from creating quilts, and every curtain in the house it was made by her, and bedspread. She loves like the domestic arts, and she also loves to sing. So that pairing is also there. The sage also lends itself to creativity as well. Jacqueline Broyer in Boomerang, one of my favorite examples of sage energy. In the movie Boomerang, Jacqueline Broyer plays an executive who encounters a playboy, and she becomes his boss.
I'm rapping. This is my Mac Daddy vibe I'm giving you in all of its splendor. What's up?
Really?
Yes, I'm the Alleganza Mac Daddy of the month.
Oh, I see. Well, let me get a good look.
Check it. It's like Jet Magazine. What's up?
You are absolutely wonderful. But I think that we should kind of make this clear right from the start so there's no misunderstanding. You see, I don't date men I work with.
Well, then I quit.
You can't quit because I need you.
And of course he is smitten with her, and she wields a textbook seduction on him and also gives him a taste of his own medicine. Her coolness, her intellect, her ability to remain emotionally cool and distance from the situation so she's in control of herself. She's exuding passion, but she's totally in control of it. Is remarkable. It's what makes her seductive, and it's a great example of the sage. If you ever watched that movie, if you watched it before, like huntresses, sages not only exude a cool energy, but they are also fundamentally independent, meaning that their sense of identity comes from within, and it's not defined in relationship to others.
You live very well, don't you?
More often, sage women are defined by their accomplishments, but also a lot of times they can be defined by their relation to powerful men. It just kind of depends on how you've tapped into the archetypes. A lot of these archetypes have their patriarchal incarnations, meaning they've taken these very ancient archetypes. They've been very much influenced by patriarchy and male interests. And so you have a lot of women who identify with sage, who cape very hard for men or align themselves with powerful men. But when you go deep into the archetype, and you kind of go beyond patriarchy, which is one of my which is where my research lies. And my research in archetypes is really going beyond where the archetypes are now and go and exploring the sort of ancient roots, so we can see the true capacity for women who have these archetypes. When you go there, you see that this is the archetype of strategy. This is the archetype of war. This is Inanna, goddess of sex and war. This is the archetype of wielding passion seductively with strategy. Cleopatra is a sage woman. This is also the archetype of inspiring powerful men. So you'll see, like Hillary Clinton, a lot of sage women are naturally, just like the queen, drawn to very powerful men because they kind of they see eye to eye. They see each other. Amal Clooney, great example. Oprah Winfrey, a sage woman and kind of playing a big role in enlightening humanity, if you will. Jacqueline Kennedy, a sage woman known for being bookish and not only loving fashion, but also loving the arts and loving literature. This is the archetype that you will see if you turn on cable news. From Christiane Amanpour to Soledad O'Brien, this is really the archetypal newscaster. So a lot of women, female journalists, really either identified with this archetype or sort of appear like this archetype, because it is the archetype of wisdom, it's the archetype of facts, it's the archetype of making sense of things and taking a pragmatic approach. Olivia Pope on Scandal, Claire Huxtable on The Cosby Show.
Coffee?
Yeah, coffee.
You mean you're gonna get it?
Yes, you're surprised?
I'm sorry, Mrs. Huxtable, I didn't think you did that kind of thing.
What kind of thing?
You know, serve.
Serve whom?
Serve him.
Oh, serve him! As in serve your man?
Well, yeah.
Let me tell you something, Elvis. You see, I am not serving Dr. Huxtable, okay?
Okay.
That's the kind of thing that goes on in a restaurant. Now, I'm going to bring him a cup of coffee, just like he brought me a cup of coffee this morning. And that, young man, is what marriage is made of. It is give and take 50-50. And if you don't get it together and drop these macho attitudes, you are never going to have anybody bringing you anything, anywhere, anyplace, anytime, ever.
Julia Sugarbaker on Designing Women.
On my knees and pray every day, on my own turf, on my own time. One of the things that I pray for, Mr. Brickett, is that people with power will get good sense. And people with good sense will get power. And that the rest of us will be blessed with the patience and the strength to survive the people like you in the meantime.
I would say sage women have a unique challenge of connecting to their body and really feeling comfortable in their sensuality, because a lot of them can be so based in the head, it's very difficult for them to not only make the transition and the connection to the heart, the realm of emotions. A lot of them feel very uncomfortable with emotions, but also feeling comfortable in their own body and their sensuality. So a lot of sage women, if you really talk to them about sex and they really identify with it strongly and they haven't figured out how to integrate their other archetypes, they will say that during sex they're in their head and it's very hard for them to really engage in the fully sensual experience. And so a lot of sage women kind of have to work hard at combining the sage with their lover energy. A lot of times it can literally be at war in their psyche until they really understand how the sage can work together with lover energy or other energies as well. In terms of being male identified, in a lot of sage women actually tapping into the aspect of this archetype that sort of is more so defined by patriarchy and being a champion for masculinity. Think about Condoleezza Rice, you know, a sage woman, brilliant woman, but she was the essential ally to President Bush. Or Ivanka Trump, think about her loyalty to President Trump. And just as much as a sage woman can cape for men, they really can cape for women. I mean, some of the most renowned feminists, Camille Paglia, Gloria Steinem, are certainly sage women as well, and you can cape for both too, you know. But it's just a matter of levels. I mean, all these archetypes have levels at which we can align ourselves, and you know, at the most basic level, for example, with the lover archetype, the tip of the iceberg is, you know, connecting to your sexuality, wearing a nice dress, connecting to your sensuality. But at the deepest, most ancient, most powerful level of that archetype. It's the ability to alter reality and create reality. And same thing with the sage. You can approach it at the, you know, the tip of the iceberg, which is sort of, you know, being in the proximity of power. Or you can approach that archetype and really get to the deepest level of that archetype, which is the ability to command an immense wisdom, immense strategy, immense foresight, and to really be a queen of, you know, both the boudoir and the battlefield, if you will. That honestly is the most ancient relic of the sage archetype. And sages are often secret weapons. This is the last note I want to leave with you. It's not a coincidence that you will find a lot of sage women paired with incredibly powerful men. When it comes to queen women have a knack for identifying kings and for partnering up and cozying up to kings. But when it comes to sage women make kings. So it's not a coincidence that Michelle Obama, a sage woman who also has a bit of mother and lover as well, not a coincidence that Michelle Obama was with Barack Obama, not a coincidence that Jacqueline Kennedy was with John F. Kennedy, not a coincidence with Carla Bruni Sarkozy. A lot of first ladies of Bill and Hillary Clinton, another great example. A lot of first ladies and a lot of wives of powerful men are sage women, in part because they are drawn to ambitious and intelligent men with a knack for leadership, but in part because these are counselors. They are sages in the sense of, think back to the oldest, most ancient meaning of sage. You went and you sought after the sage's wise counsel, the sage's the oracle, if you will. You know, you went and this person had this prized, highly valued knowledge, and it wasn't just fact knowledge. It was knowledge based in experience and also instinct and intuition. And this person could advise you. And that's what a lot of sage women do incredibly well. Like, they have a knack for, if this is where you want to go, they can create the roadmap to get you there. So they are often not just powerful themselves, but they are often the secret weapon behind powerful men. And that is the sage. Let me upgrade your autumn upper page. You're switching legs out of purple labels. Upgrade you.
After all, we both share the same type.
You had it once. I have it now. There's a big difference. Whatever your motives are.
Motives? That's an ugly implication.
You came back to hurt my husband. First in court and now by moving in. All right, that's your business. Maybe your disease. But my business is to protect my husband. His peace of mind, for one thing. I don't have to tell you what he's been through.
That man murdered my son's, his son's best friend. You don't have to tell anyone, Mrs. Jennings.
Oh,
I'm terribly sorry. That was your other husband's name, wasn't it? I mean, Mrs. Carrington.
I want you out of our house.
Now, speaking of first lady, when you think of queen, you can also think of first lady. Think first lady of the country, like Nancy Reagan or Barbara Bush. Think of first lady of the church. First lady in the sense of the matriarchal figure, the center of gravity for family, for community, and even for a nation. That is the queen. The 80s was the era of the queen. 80s, we had all of these dramas, evening dramas, if you will, Dynasty in Dallas, and they featured these very regal women who were reigning in their castles, but they also were connected to powerful men. So they were queens, but their power came from their alliance and often their marriage to, or former marriage to, a powerful man. That was kind of their center of orbit. But if you look at fashion from the 80s, so influenced by Nancy Reagan, so influenced by Alexis Carrington with the shoulder pads, it was the era of, you know, opulence, of of, you know, coiffed hair, of jewels, of, you know, lots of blush and strong makeup and shoulder pads and tailored outfits and peplums and high-heeled shoes. And, you know, the shoes match the purse, match the hat, match the bag. It was that era being very well put together. And it was, you know, the country, you know, was doing very well economically in the 80s. So it was the era of money. So the queen was really the resonant image of the woman in the 80s. One of the interesting places you can find the queen today is in reality TV, especially the Housewives franchise.
Now, you can say whatever you want to me. I really don't care. But you shouldn't have addressed my mom.
I said it. I'm not taking it back.
Never do.
There is always a queen. And if you look at The Real Housewives of Atlanta, it's NeNe Leakes. If you look at The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, it's Lisa Vanderpump. Real Housewives of Potomac, it's Karen Huger. She is the grand dame, if you will. She's the matriarch. She's sort of the center of gravity. Things kind of silently and very subtly revolve around them. They're kind of the de facto leaders, you know, the queen bees of their social circle. That is that queen energy. Now, the queen is sort of a natural leader. Not only is she the archetypal wife and the archetypal matriarch, so that center of gravity for family, for community, but the queen is a natural social butterfly. She's naturally a leader, and she leads by inspiration. People kind of like her. They want to be around her. They're inspired by her, and sometimes they want to emulate her. Often she's the glue that keeps groups of people together. She is a natural connector. She's often naturally confident, and she's got a knack for having a man. Like, queen women are the women that oftentimes, like, when they're younger, they always have a boyfriend, and when they, you know, are older, they are married, and even if they get divorced, trust me, they'll be married again. I actually know a queen woman who sells Mary Kay. She's very high up in the Mary Kay business, and actually Mary Kay Ash, a queen woman, many female entrepreneurs are. It's the archetypal wife, but that's like the tip of the iceberg. When you really dig deep into the archetype, it's the leader. She's a natural born leader. She's the regent, and a lot of women channel that energy into building profound businesses, and often businesses that involve women. So anyway, this woman that I know, she's a queen woman, high up in the Mary Kay. She was also the first lady of a church, and she and her husband divorced. And honey, she was remarried before he was. So they have a knack for that.
I know when you were little girls, you dreamt of being in my world. Don't forget it, don't forget it. Respect that, bow down, bitches. Time to live my life, but don't think I'm just his little wife.
Now we know Queen Bee. Queen Bee is a diva. That's her seduction archetype, Beyonce. So that means she's dominated by lover energy, but she's got very high, high queen energy. And like I said before, her mom is also dominated by that queen energy. And when Tina Knowles parted from Matthew Knowles, it was a pretty ugly split. You know, he committed some infidelities in the public eye. It was pretty humiliating. And once again, I don't know what Matthew Knowles is doing, but Tina Knowles is living her very best life with her new husband. And if you look at Beyonce, as accomplished as this woman is, she is a wife. And she's been a wife for a long time, and she's a mom, and she's got a family. That is something that is very resonant with queen women. And actually, one of their big hurdles is that until they find their partner, because they find fulfillment, so much fulfillment and self-actualization in the role of partner, and they are great companions. They're just great at companionship. Until they find that one, they will feel very, very restless, especially if they haven't figured out and tapped into the higher aspects of their archetypal energy and figured out how to channel that for good use. Joan on Mad Men, a great example of the queen energy, as is Naturi Naughton's character, Tasha St. Patrick on Power. Another aspect of this energy is not only are they excellent companions, but they are the very embodiment of loyalty. Like, these are your ride or die women. These are the women that are, if they're with you, y'all are thick as thieves. They stick by their man, but just not their not just their man, they stick by their cause. They stick by their purpose. They stick by their family, even if their family isn't kin, even if their family is community or country. These are women that embody the idea of loyalty. They also embody the idea of the finer things in life. A lot of times you can identify queen women just by looking at them. There is an air of elegance. I always notice that queen women tend to have like beautiful jewelry, but there's always something very regal done up about them, especially if they're going someplace. This is a woman that is not going to dress for comfort. She's not going to necessarily dress like a lover to be, you know, enticing, but she's always going to elevate herself with you know, her styling, particularly if she's really embracing her archetype. They have a natural elegance about them, a natural regal demeanor. We tap into the queen energy when we want confidence, when we want to become more extroverted, when we need to make friends and make social allies, and you know, move with the power of a network behind us. We tap into the queen when we want to bring the finer things and luxury into our lives. We tap into the queen when we're ready to get married, quite frankly. When you're ready to kind of move from the place of having these, you know, fun little liaisons, and some women do arrive at a point in their life where they're like, okay, this is the year, I'm ready. And that like instinct builds up in you, that queen starts when you fully tap into the queen. The queen will get you married. That's her archetype. Like, the lover will make you seductive and beguiling and get you noticed and will get your options and will get you out there, and your love light will literally be on. And then the queen will allow you to focus and find that one and create companionship with that one. That's what that queen energy does. So you can channel this energy in a number of ways. You can channel it into a family for sure, but you can just as easily channel it into building an empire and being the queen of your own empire. And today, many female entrepreneurs, particularly those who run brands that are geared towards women, embody this queen energy and pull upon this queen energy to accomplish their goals. Where do you go when there's a need to be loved like you need to be loved? Oh, I'll let you know.
Ma sì, ha ragione lei, sto sbagliando tutto. Stiamo sbagliando tutto.
I think the best example of mother energy in popular culture right now, it's easy, is Ayesha Curry. She is kind of like the girl next door. She comes across as very warm, as friendly, as affable. Like, she's an attractive woman, and you know that she lives a lifestyle that a lot of other women don't, yet there's something about her that seems normal and approachable, like literally the girl next door. And that's kind of what the mother energy is. Mother is all about nurturing life, protecting life. And so at the most basic level, and this is probably next to the lover, along with the lover, the most ancient and powerful and intrinsic feminine archetype, the lover and the mother, because they fulfill both instincts to procreate and sustain life, you know, raise a child and that child survives. So on the most intrinsic level, the mother represents that desire to nurture and sustain. And that can be in a number of ways. That can be physically nurturing, like a woman breastfeeding a child or feeding a child or taking care of a child. But it could be spiritually nurturing. It could be emotionally nurturing, being a source of emotional support. A lot of times, women who identify with the mother archetype, if they go out in a group of friends, they're the ones that are, you know, making sure everybody's okay. They might be the designated driver, and they're making sure everybody's all right. These women tend to be approachable. These women tend to be down to earth, you know, not too pretentious. Their energy is very warm. Their energy tends to be very inviting. That's actually one of the most enchanting things about them, is that they're, I won't say there's no mystery, but you feel at ease in their presence. These women tend to be very resilient, and they embrace the notion of family, whether that family is kin, their circle of friends, or their community, or even their country. In popular culture, you've seen the mother. She's Harriet Winslow. She is June Cleaver. She's Carol Brady, Julia Child. And on a larger, more humanitarian notion of this archetype, she's Mother Teresa, you know, who represents the concept of mothering humanity. Mothers are nourishers, and they are sustainers, and they fight for the causes and the people that matter to them most. They are determined. And again, like the lover, this is the most ancient primordial archetype. It represents our capacity to not only give birth, but also to sustain life. One of the reasons why women who have dominant lover and mother energy are so seductive is because both of these energies, both these archetypes, are really the most ancient feminine archetypes there are, and they're most essential and they're most instinctive. And so if you see a Sophia Loren or if you see a Nia Long, and there's something about them that's just palpable, just oozes off the screen, it's like an earthy magnetism. That's why it is literally that most ancient force emanating from them. Even in Erykah Badu, who has plenty of huntress, but also that huntress is combined with lover and mother energy, and it makes her, it gives her a sort of earthy presence, where as different and eccentric as she is, there's something warm and even nurturing about her. And if you watch the case study on in the Five Laws of Feminine Power of Erykah Badu, that's part of her unique seductive appeal. It's not just that she is a challenge due to that huntress nature, but there's also part of her that is incredibly nurturing. And men, you know, men sometimes want to be mothered. That actually can be a seductive thing. The other side of that is that for women who do have ample amounts of lover and mother, or who have mother energy and are attempting to cultivate lover energy and to get that balance, it can be difficult. And it can be difficult due to our patriarchal society and this whole idea of the Madonna whore complex, and the fact that we kind of teach women that you can, we kind of separate sex from the process of mothering, you know? So this idea of the ultimate virgin mother, this Madonna, that once you become a mother, you know, you're kind of asexual, versus if you are a sexual being, that's not motherly. We've separated these two spheres. We've taken these ancient energies and these ancient archetypes, and we've really twisted them to a point where we can't even recognize them anymore. So for that reason, a lot of women who identify with mother and lover, or even either of those two, have a hard time really making sense of their energy and tapping into the real power of their energy. Because if you're looking to society to kind of help you find your identity, you're going to find a very distorted concept of your identity. And so a lot of times, again, for women who really identify with that mother energy, it takes them a bit of understanding to kind of really embrace their sexuality, their sensuality as well.
Come on, Annie, think of something clever to say, huh? Something full of magic, religion, bullshit. Come on, dazzle me.
I want you.
What?
I said I want you.
Another interesting thing about mothers, they tend to be very down to earth, very approachable. Jill Scott, Oprah, Michelle Obama, Dolly Parton, Susan Sarandon, all of these women have ample amounts of mother energy. I know I said that both Oprah and Michelle Obama are sage women, but they also have ample amounts of mother energy. And that's actually what makes them approachable. If you look at Michelle Obama, you know, when she got into the White House, what did she call herself? She called herself Mom in Chief. And we knew she was an intelligent woman. We knew she was Princeton and Harvard Law. We knew she could give a speech just as fiery as her husband, but she made mothering her priority, and she made, you know, childhood obesity, you know, working with children and gardening, these very sort of mothering activities high on her agenda. It reflects, number one, her strategy as first lady, because she is a sage, but it also reflects that aspect of her personality, that mothering instinct is a really big part of her personality, and one of the things that makes her so approachable. Oprah Winfrey would be the same way. Oprah is obviously, you know, a sage, obviously a businesswoman, has really contributed a lot to the enlightenment of humanity, but what really makes her remarkable is the fact that she might sit down in an interview, and at the end of the interview, both of the people, she and the person, are crying. There's something open about her, disarming about her, and that comes from that mother energy. So we cultivate this energy, all of us, when we need to literally mother. So a lot of women will really experience this energy on a biological level, like the hormones kicking in when they start families and when they become mothers, and it's like it comes on strong when you're connecting to your baby, and that archetype, you know, enters your life with a hurricane force and never leaves. But this energy also helps us transcend ego, and it helps us connect. It helps us create heart-centered, real, down-to-earth relationships with our friends, with our families. It lets us go from a place of kind of just being heady and, you know, nice conversation to really establishing heart-based emotional deep roots. And so for women that, again, that are looking to create something deep with the man and to go deeper with the man, not just, you know, because the seduction is tantalizing and it's heady, but at a certain point, once, you know, the seduction is really kicked in, you got to take it from the chase to something, you know, with roots. That's what the mother energy does. The mother energy is also seductive because, you know, you're a purveyor of creature comforts. There's something about going to something about creating a home and creating a space that's warm and inviting, and, you know, a nice cooked meal and cozying up by the fire. And there's something about, you know, a woman that is just approachable, and you feel like, you know, you can confide in her and you feel like she's your friend. The mother energy kind of does that. For seduction, just for anything, you have to be able to access all seven of these archetypes. That's kind of the advantage of the mother archetype, at least in seduction. And mother energy also opens up the floodgates of compassion, emotional connection, and creation. And it helps us really recognize and cater to the needs of others. And that's an invaluable tool, not only in nurturing, but also when it comes to charm and seduction. I'm yours, you're mine, like paradise.
How's your leg?
It hurts a little.
And your stomach?
Empty as a football.
And your love life?
Not too active.
Anything else bothering you?
Mm-hmm. Who are you?
Reading from top to bottom. Lisa. Carol. Fremont.
I would say that the mystic is probably the most underrepresented in popular culture and also the most misunderstood, but actually quite present. I realize, like, even though you don't see the mystical lot in popular culture, and it's this energy so misunderstood, it's actually quite present in terms of the percentage of, at least the percentage of women that take the quiz on my site. There are quite a few women that identify very strongly with mystic energy. So the mystic really represents the independent, creative, introverted woman who prioritizes more than anything her inner peace, her tranquility, higher levels of consciousness. It's that energy where you don't really need to be interacting with the rest of the world. You can find your fulfillment through the spirit. If you've ever been in a home with a warm fire blazing and there's just this feeling of, it's cold outside and you're sitting by the fire and you just feel relaxed and you feel comfortable and you feel at peace and you feel tranquil, that feeling, it's hard to describe, but that's basically what the mystic feeling is. Like, she's embodied by the hearth. Like, she represents the warmth at the core of a home, the warmth at the core of a family, the warmth at the core of society. Oftentimes these women, yes, they're introverted, but they often are soulful. There's something soulful about them. There's something serene about them. There's something tranquil about them. And there's something warm and magnetic about them. So if we look at Sade, if you look at Nicole Kidman, Greta Garbo, Frida Kahlo, these are famous mystic women. What really enticed us about them the most was the fact that they was their introversion, the fact that we couldn't get enough of them. Frida Kahlo, her artwork actually often reflected her introversion. Sade, as a musical artist, you know, if you listen to her voice, it is calm. It's like a fire.
This may come, as some surprise, but I miss you.
It's like a fire blazing. It's calm, it's serene, but people love it. And she's got this sort of magnetic, soulful, tranquil, serene presence. And she literally comes out with an album like once a decade and yet stays on the airwaves and stays relevant. We are enamored by the distance just as much as we're enamored by the serenity and the tranquility and the soulfulness of her. Grace Kelly retreated from Hollywood, from Monaco, after she became princess. But even today, we remember her serene, dignified nature. Greta Garbo's mystery is what made her an enduring screen siren. Nicole Kidman is a little bit more extroverted. She would be a goddess, which would be a dominant lover, secondary mystic. But even Nicole Kidman, it's not just her beauty that enamors us, but is a sense of sort of tranquility, this sort of a dream come to life persona. The mystic in terms of seduction really inspires men to dream. There's something about her that is ethereal. There's something about her that is just beyond a human, you know what I mean? Like, if human is to be flawed, there's something about her that's kind of dignified and something very serene. Oftentimes, mystic women will have to work to understand their unique energy and their unique lifestyle needs because it's so misunderstood and kind of underrepresented in popular culture. Oftentimes, they may have to develop assertiveness and they may have to learn to work with their lover energy, which can sometimes be at odds with the mystic energy. The reason why we cultivate the mystic, and all women need to cultivate the mystic, just like the other six archetypes, is to get grounded, to learn how to live in the present, to achieve some sort of emotional distance. You know, emotional distance, I keep talking about that, but emotional distance is what allows you to think clearly when you're angry, is what allows you to think clearly when you're overwhelmed, when you are really, really happy even, or really sad, or when you're in love, you know, more than anything, when you're enamored with somebody, it allows you to kind of take yourself out of the emotion and still be able to make really good decisions, you know, even when you're overcome with the emotion. So the mystic is something that helps with emotional distance. The mystic helps you maintain your identity, your sense of inner peace, and it helps you kind of part from things that jeopardize and compromise your sense of inner peace and tranquility. It helps you overcome issues with needing validation, needing attention. It helps you overcome codependency issues that may come along with some of the other archetypes like the queen, the mother, and the maiden. It helps you overcome impulsiveness, but more than anything, the mystic really helps you develop that seductive distance that all successful, you know, seductive relationships really need. Sort of the interplay of intimacy mixed with a little distance just to increase that aspect of desire, and that's kind of how the mystic can help all women. I think true confidence and personal power comes from building a life that is totally in alignment with who you are at your core. And for women, that's really, really hard. I think this is one of the reasons why feminine archetypes are so powerful and eye-opening for women, because women more than any, certainly more than men, are really molded in society. We're told who to be all the time. For women to be independent is like an act of revolution, you know, independent in identity. We are told how to be as daughters. We are told how to be as lovers. We're told how to be as mothers and wives. And so for women to really figure out who they are at their core and to build a life around that, that's where true power and confidence and courage comes from. That's how women really begin to radiate that powerful energy, just because they're living a life that is reflective of who they are. They're living authentically. They're honoring who they are. It's also important to have access to all seven of the archetypes, because they are all different expressions of feminine energy, and they all balance each other out. So if you are unable to at least access any of those archetypes, you will feel it. There will be an area of your life in which you're significantly lacking because you lack any connection with that archetype. If you want to learn more about archetypes or figure out what your unique personality blueprint is or what your seduction archetype is, you can visit womenlovepower.com. And if you really want to dive deep and learn how to connect to these archetypes, learn the practices, the prompts, and really dive deep into understanding the power that exists, the highest power that exists in all of these archetypes, I hope that you would join me in the Feminine Odyssey. It's a series of 7 masterclasses where we are diving deep into all 7 feminine archetypes, beginning with the most significant, the lover archetype. So for those of you who are interested in learning how to incorporate that lover energy, that erotic, creative life force energy into your life, what practices you can do to awaken that energy, how to understand that energy, how to work with that energy, and how to take it from a place of sensuality to even the capacity to manifest and create your own destiny, we are diving really deep into this archetype. And so if you only take one of the master classes, I would recommend you take that one. I think of all the courses, that's going to be the one that has the instant impact on your life. And the information for that is below. And until next time, my name is Aisha, and I hope you'll also join me at womenlovepower.com.